Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ, and a warm welcome to everyone to Watana Church English Worship Service. Praise the Lord for giving us a new day to come together to worship Him. Although it has been raining this morning, and it might make it difficult for people to travel here, we want to thank God for all the things He has given us throughout the past week. Time passes by so quickly, and now we are already into the half year of 2015. Our God is faithful, and His love for us endures forever. Let us worship Him with our hearts and minds with gratefulness. Call to worship is from Psalms 117, verses 1 to 2. Praise the Lord, all you Gentiles. Love Him, all you peoples, for His merciful kindness is great toward us. And the truth of the Lord endures forever. Praise the Lord. Let us sing hymn, Come Christians, Joy to Sing. Will the congregation please rise? Personal prayer and confession, and Ajahn Paul will lead us for the assurance of pardon.
We welcome you all this morning. We know some areas are flooded, so there will be others joining us later. But we're glad you're here, and we'll take these few moments to be quiet before the Lord on a very personal basis level, so that we can prepare our hearts to come before the Lord in worship. Let's take these next few moments to be just quiet before the Lord personally. If there is anything that in your heart Holy Spirit reminds you needs confessing, then this is the time that we take to prepare our hearts. The assurance of pardon comes to us from Micah in the Old Testament, chapter 7, verses 18 and 19. Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over the transgressions of the remnant of his heritage? He does not retain his anger forever, because he delights in mercy. He will again have compassion on us and subdue our iniquities. He will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. Let's pray together. Our loving Heavenly Father, as we, your people, come before you once again this morning, we come in the precious name of your Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, Lord, we come first of all to bow in worship, in homage, in joy. We thank you for who you are. We rejoice in all that you have done. Lord Jesus, again, we thank you for being obedient to your Father's eternal will. And because of your obedience, we can be reconciled to your holy and our holy Heavenly Father. We can be cleansed, restored, renewed. We bow before you again this morning to thank you. Your word also reminds us that you have not finished with regards to your ministry for your people. That even as we are bowed before you this morning, you are at the Father's side, interceding for us. And we thank you. Teach us, Lord, to intercede for one another, to intercede for Thailand, for our families, for our friends. For our neighbors. Again, we thank you for all that you have done. We thank you for all that you are doing. And we are confident and thank you and praise you for all that you are going to do in the future for each one who seeks to follow you and honor you in their lives. We thank you for our brother and his family who are with us today to share your word. We ask your richest blessing upon them and in their work. We again remember our pastor and the pastoral team. We think of each elder and others who are involved in the ministry here at Watonau Church. We know the Sunday school is in session at the moment, and again we commit each life to you who is gathered for Sunday school this morning. Bless each teacher and each student. Again, we want to remember those who are unwell, whatever their ailment, whatever their problem. Loving Father, again, we commit them lovingly to you this morning and pray that in mercy you would touch each one. Whether they have a physical need or any other kind of need, we recognize, Lord, that we are a needy people. We come before you humbly and ask in your precious name that you, by your Spirit, would be meeting each need in each life. Now let's take a moment to say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Forever. Amen. Let's praise the Lord for his grace, for his power, for his mercy. Before we just turn to the back of the bulletin, can we just take a moment to greet one another in the name of the Lord? If you're close enough and you want to say something, just say something like, may the Lord bless, may the peace of God be upon you. I'm going to wye everybody and rejoice with you that we can share in our morning worship hour together. Is anybody here for the first time? Anyone? No? Okay. If you are to be blessed this morning, I would encourage you to bring a friend, family member, whoever is willing to join us for this Sunday morning worship hour. Looking at the back of the bulletin, I see again two blanks. I'm not sure if that means that some of us are not praying or we're not praising. I hope not. If anyone does have a prayer request or a praise item, we would encourage you to jot it down on a slip of paper that's in your bulletin, write clearly. You can place it in the offering bag later or give it to one of our attendees at the back before you leave. But I have two requests for prayer. Firstly, let's pray for those who have attended our worship service but are now living abroad. There are several families for which the United Nations has assisted. They were here as refugees, but they have been resettled, and they're now settling into their new communities. Let's remember them in prayer. Secondly, let's pray for those who have a real need among us. Does anyone have a need and you would like us to remember you in prayer this morning? Anyone? Okay, thank you. We'll remember you in prayer. Let's pray together. And let's remember to praise the Lord for his mercy, for his grace. Our loving Heavenly Father, we take these moments again this morning to remember those who have been with us over the past 3 years. But today they are resettling in another country and in a new community. We remember them and we commit them to you and ask, Father, that in Jesus' name and by your Spirit, you would move among them, meet their needs, we pray, as they resettle and readjust to a new life and maybe to a new lifestyle. We also remember each one of us here this morning and others who are on their way, where whatever needs we represent before you this morning, we ask in Jesus' name that you, in mercy, by your grace and by your power, will be meeting our needs. We are a needy people. Sometimes we recognize our need. Sometimes we may fail to recognize that we have a need. But we are a needy people. And Lord, again, we commit one another to you and pray in Jesus' name that you would be gracious and merciful to us in meeting each of our needs. And to your name, we will be careful to give all the praise and all the glory. We pray these things, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Scriptural reading this morning is from 1 Chronicles 28, verse 9. And you, my son Solomon, acknowledge the God of your father and serve him with wholehearted devotion and with a willing mind. For the Lord searches every heart and understands every desire and every thought. If you seek him, he will be found by you. But if you forsake him, he will reject you forever. This morning, we have the pleasure to have Ajahn Albert Cheng to give us the sermon entitled Personal Devotion to God.
Morning, everybody. Praise God, and we can all come again together to this church. It's a pleasure to be here to share the words of God, and I'm asked to share on the topic of personal devotion. And what is actually personal devotion? What do we mean by the word devotion? And the word devotion that I do a search on the internet, as well as the dictionary, it actually says it means royalty, faithfulness, commitment, dedication, something that we would want to do and we're willing to do. Have you seen people walking their dogs every day? Have you seen sportsmen training very hard every day? Have you seen parents sending the student to school each day and bringing them back? Regardless rain or shine, Some musicians will play the tune over and over and over again. This is commitment. They won't stop doing it. They will keep doing it because they love to do it. They enjoy doing it. And it's part of their life. They cannot don't do it. Imagine if a musician cannot play music. It will be a very sad thing. And imagine that a sportsman cannot exercise anymore. It's something very sad. Devotion is part of our life. Every one of us here has a part of a devotion. Whatever you're devoted to, there is a reason, because you love that part of it. Then what about devotion as a Christian? Our walk with God, our daily devotion to God. What does it mean by that? It actually means that we give a part of our time each day to God, either in the morning or in the afternoon or at night. Especially just us and God together. Many people call this quiet time. Now, does the Bible say about quiet time? Any particular verse that says that in this verse, God commands us to do quiet time? No. It's not recorded there. But if we study the Bible, there are so many examples of great men of God giving their time to God. They really devote their time to seeking God, communicating with God, receive what God wants them to do, and they were successful. Example, Daniel, he'll go up to his upper room every day and kneel down facing towards Jerusalem and pray 3 times. Regardless, he will do it. Even they say that if you do that, you are going to be killed. He still do that. That's why he was landed in the lion den, because he's devoted to God. Look at King David. King David went through a lot of trouble. But every time when I read the Bible, when King David is in some kind of problem, first thing he says, he seek God. Should I go after my enemies or not? Should I do this? Should I do that? He don't just base on his own personal feeling. He go to God. And every time God says something, he do, and every time he was successful. Look at Jesus, our Lord. It's a very good example. Jesus wake up early. He went to a quiet place. He kneel down. He would talk to God. That's where he received God's words. He received the empowerment. He received the spiritual nourishment. He received all that he need to get from the Father and how he can successfully serve the ministry. And until today, what Jesus has planted 2,000 over years ago is bearing a lot of fruits today. So personal commitment to us is important, because Christianity is not a religion. It is our walk with God. And in order for us to have a very close walk with God, to have a close, intimate relationship, to be able to build our foundation, that we can hear from God, we can understand what He wants for us, what to do in our daily life, how to encourage other people, and build a life that people can see, yes, you are a Christian. That we need daily devotion. This is something whereby we all ought to do, to spend good quality time with God. And I hope after today, we can understand better about our daily devotion. Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this morning that we can come together to listen to your words about devotion. Lord, you love us to spend time with you, and we enjoy spending time with you too. Lord, every day when we walk with you and we speak to you, Lord, please speak to us. Hear our prayers, you know our needs, you know our desire, you know our problem, our pain. Lord, help us, guide us, lead us, that during this time that we talk to you, we communicate with you, you lead us in a way that we can live our life according to your will. And that whatever we do in our daily life will bring encouragement to people around us, and people can see that we are blessed by our Heavenly Father in heaven, and that they will be impressed and they want a life like us. That they want to know Jesus, and we can show them it's because Jesus, we have a new life. And they too will come to know you and they'll be safe. And your name be glorified in our walk with you. We thank you, Lord, for teaching us, guiding us, and blessing us. We commit this time to you. In the holy, mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Somebody once says, the gospel brings salvation to a man. But someone also says, it's devotion that keeps us close to God. Christians who spend time with God are Christians who grow with God. Christians who don't spend time with God are just Christians. They can be Christian for 10 years, they are still the same. No personal development, no spiritual development, they are still at the same spot. Hand me the slide, please. Yes, the next slide. In James chapter 4, verse 8, James says, James is the brother of Jesus. He wrote this and says, come near to God and he will come near to you. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. God wants us to be near him. Which parents do not want their children to be around him? Right, parents? We all want them to be near him. Even if you have a dog, you want the dog to be near you. Right? It's a type of closeness that we want together. Why God wants us to be close to him? Because it's when we are closing to him, we understand him better. Sometimes many things we cannot understand. But as we get closer to God, God shows us the way. Beginning of the year, I went through some spiritual attack. I was not feeling very too well with myself. And I wasn't decided what to do. And every day I pray to God. I say, God, I will not take any action unless you tell me to do. And I keep praying and praying and praying. Brothers and sisters, each day when I pray to God and I read God's words, God spoke to me through the Bible. Do this. Don't worry. Do that. I'm with you. And then things start to get better, better, and better. If such thing can happen to me, it can happen to you. So when we are in doubt, when we are in pain, when we are in uncertainties, brothers and sisters, my advice to you is, first thing, go down back to God. Draw near to him, because when you are near to him, you have the peace, and then you know what to do next. James is telling us to go seek God. Is this the one? It's okay. Thank you. James is telling us to go seek God so that we can understand him better, and then we can follow his commandments, and then the best part, we can hold on to his promises. We do not lose hope. Sometimes we will hope, and after a while we start to doubt, our faith start to erode, and maybe God doesn't want to give me that. Maybe God has forgotten my prayer. So we start to go away from God. James says, draw near to God and God to you. And when we are nearer to God, we know, yes, God, you promised me, you did not forget, you will fulfill. I will hold on to your promise. I hold on to your promise that you will heal my father. I hold on to your promise that you will lead me out of this financial crisis. I hold on to you that whatever I go through, Lord, you will lead me through. Our life becomes stronger with God. That is what we all need. Paul, in 2 Corinthians, can we have the next slide, please? Yes. Paul, in 2 Corinthians, wrote this, and he said to us, for God who said, let there be light in darkness, has made this light shine in our hearts, so we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. Now, why did Paul say this? He said, let light be in the darkness. About 4 years ago, 3-4 years ago, there was a financial crisis. And Europe side started to get bad, and things started to get bad. And we have a senior management meeting. And my boss says, guys, be prepared. The tornado is coming. Let's make ourselves ready for financial problem, cash flow, this and that. Make sure we don't overspend. All right, keep everything well. Do not overexpend. Control, be careful. It's coming. I wasn't feeling anything scared. Tell you the truth. I went and prayed. And you know what God told me? I said, God, the darkness is coming. What we should do? How are you going to guide us? And what I should do? I heard God very, very clearly. God said to me, during the darkest time, the Christians will shine the brightest. Hallelujah. That year was that year that my company makes the most money. We got good profit and good bonuses. And I will still hold on and always remember to tell people, do not fear when it's dark, because God will shine. and we will shine for God. And I can use this testimony for the rest of my life. When we are near to God, God will lead us our path, and we will not stumble. So, brothers and sisters, do not worry when we are facing the dark times, because we know we have a God who will brighten everything for us if we are close to Him. So, personal time spending with God, keep us with God, that we can know the direction we want to go, because God shines on that path for us to go, and we will not go wrong. That is important. Not only that, we can see God's light, that through what we deal with God, that from our heart, now we have the experience, we shine for God. We can use this experience to share and teach other people, guide other people, encourage other people, motivate other people what to do next. If I don't have the experience of a financial crisis, I can never help one who is now facing a financial crisis. If I never gone through pain, I don't know how it feels. I cannot encourage a pregnant mother what to do because I've never been pregnant before. Only pregnant mother can encourage, advise a new pregnant mother, right? Because you have the experience. The fathers can't do it. Only the mothers can do it. So it's through this type of experience that God gives to us. And it's during these type of times that's most difficult when we devote ourselves to God, spending time with Him and asking God what to do. Many people say, we have to build our house on the rock, not on the sand. Christians to build our house on the rock are Christians who ask God, not those who are asking God, God, why this happened to me? Why? No. Christians who build a house on the rock will tell God, God, this happened to me. What should I do next? And how? That will be a mature Christian asking God Lord the right questions. Lord, you teach me that I can pass through this problem, that I can learn from you. You teach me, you talk to me, you guide me, you direct me, that I can fulfill your will, that one day I can share this valuable experience with my brother and sisters around me. To those who are non-believers, that your name can be glorified, that they will want to know you. They want to know such a great God. Jesus wants us to be the light of the world. That is why we need to get near to God and let God shine our path, that we can also show people how God led our life and how we can also encourage people in going to God, that their life can be brighter now. Many years ago, as a new young believer, my church gave me a book. That time when I get a book, I had a very, very strange feeling. I tell myself, I got to record all the sermons properly. I got to learn well, because one day I will use it. I don't know that was the Holy Spirit guiding me at that time. So I was obedient enough to write down every sermon. Anything that I do not know, I will call that pastor. I say, sorry, pastor, this morning you say this point, I don't quite understand. Can you explain this to me? How? Can I see you later? And you know, I need to know this. And I've been doing that for years and years and years. Thanks God. I spent time with God. I was devoted to Him. And many years later, I came to Thailand serving God. And that book helped me so much to serve God. 13 years ago, I was praying to God that I can serve Him. I said, God, open up my eyes so that I can see where you are working, so I can work together with you. Not your will, not my will, but your will. So God, by God's will, I got to know Pastor Soon Chon from the prison ministry. And then we start working together. He wanted me to do a Bible class for the young leaders. So I did. And after so many years, there are four pastors now from that group. One in Chiang Mai, one in Chiang Rai, two in Bangkok, and also quite a few numbers of them are serving God full-time. 13 years ago, when I was in the prison, I started encouraging Chinese-speaking prisoners, whether they are from Taiwan or from China, or from Malaysia, Singapore, or from northern part of China, or from Burma. It started with a few. Now it's a few hundred. It has grown a lot. So brothers and sisters, do not underestimate that I can only do so much. No. God will use you. When you devote your time to God, you are devoting your life to God. Because the time you spend with God will never come back again. right? You spend 1 hour this morning with God. This 1 hour is gone. It's 1 hour less of your life. When God says go, devote your time and encourage this group of people, you go. You are giving your part of your life to them. When God says go, I give you these words, go and share with them and motivate them. You go. Part of your life is gone. You will not come back again. And that is, we give our one of the most valuable part of our life in glorifying God. Personal devotion lead us, guide us. It is important because why? When we go to God during our devotion time, we get spiritual nourishment. Why? Because we leak. I can today be charged up for God. Yeah. Maybe after a week later, I feel like, look at the great man of God. Some great men of God get themselves so down, right? Look at Elijah. He just won a case. Wow, he just have a great battle. 400 false prophet of Baal has been killed. And the next day when the queen, Jezebel, want to send him a note that want to kill him, he just run and say, God, I don't want to live anymore. I want to die. See, that is the syndrome that we have. We all leak. So we need to go back to God so that we can be refilled during our devotion with God. We can be re-nourished again from God. And sometimes when we go to talk to God and spend our time with Him, you'll be amazed. God do many, many funny things. Sometimes I devote my time to God in praying for other people. We call it intercession. And God do amazing, amazing things. I can see things happening. You know, there's a pastor one day tell me a story. His name is Benny Ho. He says that one day he had a dream and he died and he went to heaven. And then he was at the entrance of the heaven and then an angel greeted him and said, okay, Benny, well done. Welcome to heaven. I see your records. Actually, you've done a lot of things. You wrote books, you serve, you give, and so on. Well, very well. You preach. Very good. Very well done. But there is a little problem. Based on the amount of time that you have praying with God, you cannot achieve so much. Let me check your records, whether is it correct or not. And Benny says, I was shivering. I'm at the entrance of heaven, and now they're checking my records. So he was worried. And as he waited, he got more and more worried. And he was, oh God, if I've done anything wrong, please forgive me. And he was shaking. And then the angels came back and said, okay, Benny, we have cleared your records. You're okay. He said, wow, what a relief. He said, actually, we found out that you cannot possibly do so much. Okay? But because there's a group of people, many, many people praying for you, that's why you can achieve so much. So welcome to heaven. You are going to level 73 of heaven. Huh? Heaven got levels. Yeah. The highest level is 79. God is on the 80. Okay? So Benny said, okay lah, 73, also good. So Benny asked the angels, can you tell me who are the people that prayed for me so that I can also thank you them and pray for them? Oh, the angel says, no need. Those who are praying for you are now at level 78 already. So you see, these are the people who are intercessor. When you devote your time to pray for somebody who is sick, you are interceding for them. God can hear your prayer and heal them. When we spend our time devoting to God, many things do happen. We cannot help our friends in USA. Can we pray for them? Yes. I don't have the money to go and help this guy. Can I pray for him during my quiet time with God? Yes. I cannot heal this man. I'm not a doctor. Can God heal him through my prayers? Yes. There are so many things that we can do during our devotion, and many miracles can happen. Not only for ourselves and for other people too. Let's look at the next slide, please. Next slide is what we have read earlier, that King David was very old and is giving the throne to his son Solomon. And this is the advice that the father is telling the son clearly. Follow this. And King David told Solomon is, and you, my son Solomon, acknowledge the God of your Father. Means we have to always look at God. Brothers and sisters, look at the solution. The one that can give us the solution. Don't look at the problem. When you look at the problem, it makes you more sad, more down. But when you look at God, our great God, nothing is impossible for Him. So, acknowledge our Father in heaven and serve Him with a wholehearted devotion. God don't like people who is half-hearted. Look at the warning that Jesus said to the lukewarm church in Revelation. It's either better you be cold rather than you are lukewarm. So please, if we want to devote our time to God, do not be half-hearted. God wants a wholehearted. Don't pray to God and handphone ring. Hold on, God, hold on. Yes, friend, yeah, tonight yeah, we're going to eat. Just cut off everything. Give this special time to God. We are told to give tithes, right? We are teach to give our 10%. Right? If you can give 10% of your time, if you can 10% of your money to God, do you give 10% of your time? These are questions that I want you to think about. Money is not that important. Time to God is far more important. Because time is money cannot buy. Okay. Oops, sorry. Yep. Serve Him with a wholehearted devotion and a willing mind. If you are not willing, no one can force you to do. You can have all the time in the world and you refuse to spend time with God. That is your choice. God, our God, is not a demanding God. He won't force you to do if He doesn't want to do. He's a gentleman. That's why Jesus says, I knock. And whoever hears and open, I will come. You can choose not to open. You can choose not to hear. He let you have that decision. So we need to be willing during our devotion time. We need to really spend time. We need to spend time, especially this time, for God. Because that is what God wants me to do. So, for the Lord searches every heart and understands every motive behind the thoughts. God knows that we are in pain. Jeremiah 1:5, it says that before you were even formed, I already knew you. And the Bible also says that God knew how many hair we have on the head. So if God knows so much, do He know our pain, our thoughts, our desire? Yes. Go to God. God knows what to direct you. God knows how to direct and move your problems, how to give you the solution. During the quiet time, when you devote time to God, let God give you the answer. That is why it's so important to spend quality time with God. And you will enjoy the peace. You will enjoy. And after praying to God, let me assure you, you come out of the room a different person. You feel more confident. You now have the power to go and do things. You dare to go and talk to somebody. That comes after our personal devotion with God. Warning. David tells Solomon, if you seek Him, He will be found by you. Why if? Bible says if, because most of the time we don't do. If you don't do it, you won't get it. That's why David tells his son, if you seek Him, He will be found by you. But if you forsake Him, He will reject you forever. Oh, brothers and sisters, something very sad to say that many Christians start off very well in their life, but the ending wasn't very good. Solomon has a very good start. Fantastic good start in his life. But how did he end it? No good. Because why? He has departed from God. He got 700 wives and 300 concubines. 1,000. He start to pray to other gods. He reject God totally. Very sad, right? Well, there are many Christians today walking around on the streets. They are almost the same. They have a good start, but they didn't have a good ending. What is important is that God wants us to have a good ending. God don't care how you start. God is concerned about how you end. Whatever we do today, would we be able to one day say, Amen, today is my last breath. Tomorrow, later on, I'll go see God in heaven. would we have to say that, oh, I live a life enough. I've served God with my whole heart. I'm now willing to go home. When we start, it's not important. It's how do we end. We should end our life with something that we can actually lay back as an impact for other people. Many of us did not do the right thing at the start of life. It's okay. There is someone that says, can we have this? Mary Robinson, can we have the next slide, please? Oh, sorry. Next one. No, down. Mary Robinson says, Maria Robinson says, nobody can go back and start a new beginning, but anyone can start today and make a new ending. Our past is our past. Whatever we have did wrong in our past, whatever mistake that we have made, we did not start doing this, we forget to do that, is not important. Important thing is today, are we willing to start and say, God, today I want to have a fresh, brand new start with you. Can you guide me, teach me, and lead me? That during my time devoted to you, you speak to me, you strengthen me. And then with that, I want to use this to go serve you. I want to use this to go glorify you, that your name can be praised and honored. That is the important things for many of us. Many people will say that, I don't have the time. I fully understand that we are living in a world that is so fast. But brothers and sisters, we don't know when we will go. I don't guarantee you that today, after I walk out from this church, I can be alive. I don't know whether tomorrow I will not wake up. We all have a chop on our life, expired. Only the dead not feel. The one who fill in is God, and God knows how to fill it in. So you haven't started your daily devotion with God. You've not really put your time to spend quality time with God. I advise you to start today, because there's so much of a benefit you can get out of it. If you go and be with God, brothers and sisters, there are many, many things that you can have. Number one that you can have with God is that when you go to God and pray to God, you have the love of God surrounding you. You will have the peace of God surrounding you, and you will be able to receive a spiritual nourishment to you once again. And brothers and sisters, by devoting our time to God, in no matter what you do, everything you do is recorded in the book of life. Whatever you have sowed on this earth, you will harvest it when you're back in heaven. It's nothing gone wasted. You can just help a poor old lady cross the road. It's a form of worship. You can just encourage somebody with your words. It's a form of worship. You can just give part of your money to help a little child. It's a form of worship. This is what we devote to God. We devote to God with our heart, our time, our money, our experience, our words, our action. Sometimes just keeping quiet, listening to somebody, telling you their problem is a form of worship, because we show that we care, we love, and we do. And today, I hear this problem. Today, I go back and pray. I believe today, God is doing something for that particular person. That makes our life meaningful. Spend our time wisely with God. So, brothers and sisters, my encouragement to you, forget about the past. Start today, if you have not started, your personal devotion with God. And if those who have already started, hallelujah, praise God, continue to press on, because God loves a willing devoter. And as a Christian with God, as a son of God, it's all we need to do. I hope that God bless you all, and that during your devotion times, you get all your prayer answered, you get to be blessed, you get your spiritual nourishment, and you get everything that God has prepared for you. And most important thing is that you enjoy the time that you spend with our Heavenly Father, and that He also enjoy the time you spend with Him. God bless you all. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, We thank you for your words this morning. Bless us, O Lord Jesus, as we have learned to come to you in our quiet devotion. Lord Jesus, I ask that you teach us each and every day and how should we devote our time to you. Time in spending reading the Bible with you, to learn your words, time in doing prayers, to communicate with you, or time to encourage other people, or time to give, or time to care. Whatever we do, Lord, we bring all this glory to you, and that, Lord, your name can be glorified. And people around us can see and feel the difference, and know that we do this for them out of love, pure agape love. That, Lord Jesus, they will benefit through all these prayers, and Lord Jesus, that they can see that their life changed, and they want to be like us, and then they'll get to know Jesus, and their life will change, and they'll be saved. And your name be glorified. Oh, Father in heaven, I ask as we spend our time in our personal devotion to you, Lord, talk to us, guide us, lead us, empower us, and Lord, give us the strength to carry out your will, that whatever we do, we can bring you glory, honor, and praise. I ask that you protect all my brothers and sisters here, your angels guide them, protect them, bless them with a good week ahead, and whatever they do, Lord Jesus, your blessing flows in their life and their family. Keep them all well and good in your hands of the mighty God. May your wings cover them and protect them, and they have the best of the week in their life. I commit everybody into your hands. In the holy, mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Ajahn Chang, for the message to remind us that we are called to give our personal devotion to God and to have a closer relationship with Him. And now it's time. Offertory is from Proverbs 11, verses 24 to 25. There is one who scatters, yet increases more, and there is one who withholds more than is right, but it leads to poverty. The generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be water himself. Offerings and hymn, let us sing hymn, My Jesus, as Thou Wilt. Please sit it while we by the offering bags are passing. With thee, thy
Well, let's all stand and sing together the doxology in praise to our Heavenly Father.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Our loving Father, again we thank you for your word. We ask that we may be those who not only listen, but do. And so I ask, Lord, that you'll help us to be obedient to your word throughout this coming week and the days to come, that our lives, Lord, may reflect your love and mercy and grace day by day. Now may your peace and blessing of God the Father, the grace of God the Father, God the Son, the Lord Jesus, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of us in the coming days. Pray these things, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Be seated as you go into this coming week. I'm sure the Holy Spirit will remind you of the word that has come to us this morning on the very important topic of being devoted to the Lord and obeying and following Him. The Lord bless each one of you in Jesus' name. Amen.